To see you all out today. Just a couple announcements. Thanks again for everybody who helped decorate the church last week. Good job for all you people who stayed. Yay. We really were grateful, and we had some people come back from first service, so it's wonderful. The gala is Tuesday night. Thursday will be the bring gifts back. Friday will be the pack the lunch, love boxes, and Saturday will be delivery for everything. Sunday will be cookie walk. So that is a big week, and I forgot to tell first service all that. So, and now also Thursday night, we will be having a mountain mission truck, so we will need volunteers at 4 o'clock to help load that. So if you're able to do that, please do that. And we also have heifer animals for sale out in the foyer if that's something you like to give for Christmas like our family does. That's right out there in the foyer. And our Advent devotionals are out there in the foyer for you too with the worksheets, which we'll talk about here in a few more minutes. All right, I think that's, yes. Oh, yes, and don't forget to come on 2 weeks on the Wednesday, the 14th, to help people dress. The third and fourth graders need help dressing for the Christmas program. And cookies and yeah, right, for that. And that'll be in 2 weeks. Yep, so that is wonderful. All right. That is all the announcements. We got a bunch of great birthdays. Sankins and Glenn Siebert's got his birthday. Jane Hoffman, I missed Jane's today. Oops. Kurt Cooper's got his. Jared, lots of great birthdays. Jake, great birthdays. So Marty out in California, happy birthday to all of them. Well, friends, happy anniversary. If you're having an anniversary and we don't know about it, please let us know. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time,
God is good.
Let's stand together and sing our opening praise, O come, Emmanuel.
And ransom captive is right.
I neglected to introduce Brandon Huffman, our new director of music, who's leading our worship team. Welcome, Brandon. Welcome back, we should say, right? You all probably know Brandon much better than I do. All right, Golden Family, are you ready to come up? Come on up. And Mr. Knox is staying in the pew with Nina. Yeah, he's sleeping. We're glad. We're so glad he's here. And you're all here. That's right there. Here it is. Sure, no problem.
Good morning.
Oh, good morning. Good morning. It's off to a bang.
You're awake now.
You're doing fine. That thing is picky.
Today we light the Advent candles of hope and love. Joseph was reminded of the closeness of God's kingdom and the power of God's love when an angel spoke to him in a dream, telling him Mary's baby was Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. God is with us. That truth fills us with hope and reminds us of God's great love for us. We light our first candle to remind us to be people whose hope is in the Lord. We light our second candle as a reminder of God's great love for us in Jesus. Let us pray. God of the Advent, we come this morning looking for signs of love, signs of hope, signs of mercy. You have promised to give us a new heart and a new spirit when we open our lives to your transforming love. In Jesus' name we come. Amen.
Amen. Good job. Thank you. And nice as always. Thank you. Thank you, Golden Family. Thank you, Miss Larkin, for helping. With our Advent service, it changes our time around a little bit, but now it's our time to collect our offering. And so we are so grateful for all that God gives us, especially for his son Jesus and this season of hope and love. The ways we show our love and praise to our great God is to show our trust is also by what we give. And so let us do so with joyful hearts and thankfulness and trusting that God will provide for us as he has always done. And so let us present our tithes and offerings. And don't forget to fill out your attendance register in your pew. If you have anything you need to send up to the front, please do during that time. Let's join in singing our next song of praise, Silent Night.
So tender and mild, sweet and
Let us pray together. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you sent Jesus to us, that he has been born, that he has lived, died, and rose, that we might know victory in all things. And today, as we present our tithes and offerings, we ask that you accept our gifts, that you multiply them, and that you help us to use all our resources to give glory to you and to further your kingdom. To share the good news that Jesus has come and is coming so that people can know your love and be filled with hope in fresh new ways. We ask this all in Jesus' precious name. And all God's people say, amen. Well, friends, our scripture lesson today is one that often people know. It's John 3:16-17. Jesus is telling Nicodemus about God's intent and God's plan and inviting Nicodemus to find new life in him. So let's share this wonderful passage that is very familiar to many of us from this, and we'll talk about love today. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. God sent his Son into the world, not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to our great God. Amen. Well, I hope you've been using our Advent devotional, but if you haven't, it's not too late. There's plenty of copies out here on the table. There's lots of things out there on the table. So this morning at first service, someone asked after first service to get her a copy, and I couldn't find them because they were stacked up nicely. It was very nice right in front of my face kind of thing. But they're out there, and also the weekly activity pages are out there. And the weekly activity pages give us opportunities to do a couple things. One thing these I've noticed in this devotional is that it gives you the opportunity to learn new scripture and invite you to repeat the scripture and memorize scripture. So that's something you've been wanting to do. This Advent devotional is a way to help you do that as you journey towards Christmas. But also, the activities have been kind of fun. If you're artistic at all, it's a good way to share artwork and scripture with others. And I hope some of you take advantage of that, because I'll tell you that that does encourage people, and I know that from my own personal experience. You wouldn't think a pastor would need to be encouraged by scripture, but some days you do. And so when adult coloring books had first come out, I sent one to my family that they like to be artistic and stuff. And I thought this might be a way for them to get a little more scripture in their lives. And so I was surprised one day when in the mail I got a beautiful colored scripture back, and how encouraging that was to me, and that they had done it and that they had sent it to me to encourage me. So I hope you do that. There's a hope page, and there's some other coloring pages that you could share with other people. And that's an easy way to share your faith. We're not always good about sharing the good news of Jesus, and that's something we really can work on. And this Advent gives you an opportunity, our Advent Bible study, our Advent devotional gives us the opportunity to do that. And so towards the end of the week, it also said that one of the activities that I thought was really a pertinent activity that I wonder how much we do is to tell people that we love them, and especially to tell our children that not only do we love them, but that God loves them in Jesus Christ. So how often are you good about telling people you love them? And better, are you good about telling people that God loves them in Jesus Christ, especially children? Do you know that the children in your life know that they are loved by God because of Jesus? Do you know it yourself? Is that some truth you claim and live? Too often we do not take the opportunity we're given to speak love to one another, and especially the love God has for us in Jesus. Jesus tells us very plainly that God is love, and that God loved the world so much that he sent love, which is Jesus. And that this love gives us great power. And if we believe in Jesus, we love. That's the sign of our faith. That's simple and difficult. We've just survived Thanksgiving, so I'm sure some of you know how more difficult it is to love people around the Thanksgiving table. Love is the anchor of our life, and it's the anchor of our faith. And if we don't have it, no matter what else we may have, all the riches, all the influence, all the power, if we lack love, especially the love God has for us in Jesus Christ, the rest of it is nothing. It's meaningless. You know, the last thing Jesus told his disciples before he ascended into heaven, or before actually got arrested, when he was forming what he wanted them to do after he was gone, was to love one another. You have all sorts of groups in this community and in your life. I mean, some of you probably are fans of different sports teams like Chicago. It's a tough road to go, but we're trying, I know. So we're a group of Chicago fans, Bear fans, and others are groups of different things. We'll have a group of people here who help with love boxes, a group of people who do Christmas for kids, a group. We have different groups, and we have all different associations and symbols of those groups. Sometimes we wear shirts. Sometimes if you're in, like, investments, the red hat ladies had red hats that I think they still wear when they meet together. It's beautiful. And so the idea of people in groups together with some kind of symbol is not hard to imagine. But the thing that Jesus did when he formed our group as Christians, he wanted our identity factor was not our skin color, not what kind of diet we ate, not what kind of apparel we wore. Our identity factor as Christians is love. And so how are you at loving? We are called as Christ followers to show our ID card, and our ID card is love. Now, that may seem easier until you really try to do it, and especially the way Jesus invited to do it. He invited us not only to love people who are easy to love, people who are like us and think like us, but Jesus made it very clear that we're to love all sorts of people. And that's really a challenge when you try to do it. If we can't love the people we do see, how are we possibly going to love the God we don't see? That's what Jesus asked. And so we need to really work on loving people. And what does that look like, our love? I mean, I like to show people to love. Sometimes I pat you. You'll notice I'm a patter, or I hug you, or I rub your arm. And I know some people don't appreciate it. My family has made it very clear. That's not appreciated, Aunt Mary. You can lay off of that. Of course I don't, but they'll, you know, that's what aunts are for, to torture their nieces and nephews. But I don't want some people to think, well, I'm attracted to them. That's not the kind of love I want to share. But I want to share God's love with people. And so it's hard to do. And so sometimes some of the most bravest, most courageous thing we can do is to figure out how to love someone who's not easy to love and love them in a safe way. You know, we have many people that are prickly in our lives. I mean, at least I do around our, we found out prickly things around Thanksgiving. I'm sure you did too. Things that you don't expect. And so how can we step up to the plate and be willing to do things that are a little more difficult and love someone else? Over Thanksgiving, we got to visit with family, and one of our family members told the story. She just started working at a hospital, and she heard this story about some interns. And one of the interns' jobs was to learn how to call doctor's offices and connect the hospital to doctors or get reports from the doctor's office. But this one intern could not make that phone call. She asked her supervisor 14 different times if the supervisor could make the phone call for her. Now that's ridiculous, right? It would have been just as easy to make the phone call as to do that 14 times contacting them. Think of the stress and anxiety around that. Well, some people get that stressed and anxious and uncomfortable when we try to think about doing loving things for others. And if you're not willing to make yourself uncomfortable a little bit, then it's really going to be hard for you to really love as Jesus invites us to love. Now, we know Christmas is the time for telling stories. Most families have stories around Christmas. My family is no exception. Of course, I have plenty of funny stories that I can't even share at church, one of them, because my father made it clear that was not a church story about our family. It's not bad, but it's not pleasant. But anyway, we know great stories cluster around the Christmas story. And so what are some of your favorite stories? But we know this, love is a theme of most of those stories. Think about Wonderful Life. The Wonderful Life story is full of people loving each other, and not just romance love. But romantic love is big business around Christmas. At least if you watch TV at all, you'll know Hallmark does it for a whole month. And now Lifetime, and now there's GAF. Those three big stations spend millions making Christmas movies all about love. Now that, of course, is often romantic love, but that is really big business. And I know that they must have a big audience, because now even places like Comedy Central and other off-brands, which do not really wouldn't be the target audience, I would think, for Hallmark people who are viewing it, they're advertising on those stations. It's amazing to me. That's how big money it is in love stories around Christmas. So what's your favorite Christmas story? My favorite Christmas story is around the little drummer boy, which I don't see that anymore on TV too often. But it's an almost tragic story. His family is tragically killed by raiders. They're murdered. All he's left with these little animals that are his friends. And as they travel into Jerusalem, as they're traveling, the wise men take most of his friends away to be working for them. And so he loses some of his friends. He's left with a little lamb. It gets hit by a Roman chariot, so his life is just completely, and he's just completely bitter, and his heart is just filled with rage for all the things that's happened to him, but he's desperate for help, and so many people do get that way. And as he seeks out help, one of the wise men just points him to baby Jesus, and he doesn't know the mystery of the manger. And so he comes in there, and just encountering the wonder of love of a baby, which we know is so precious, but especially baby Jesus, he lays his broken little lamb before him, and as his heart gets healed, the lamb gets healed. And so we know the power of love. And so whenever love is shared, we should be mindful of ourselves. That is bringing Christmas into the world. It's bringing hope into the world, joy, peace, and light. The one thing we know about love, it should be easier to love people within the church family and in the Christian community, but sometimes it isn't. And so we need to really start working hard to make sure that this building and the people in it are the places where we show love the easiest. If you're not good about telling people you love them, start here with our church family. Don't wait for me to make you practice in church either. You start it before I start practicing. If I don't hear it, I'll start practicing. And we know that we have to practice things to get better at them. So if that's not something you're comfortable doing, this is a good, safe place to start. We should love each other with words as well as deeds. We're good about deeding love. Like, there'll be a good turnout for a mountain mission, and Thursday this place will be filled with Christmas gifts. Friday there'll be lots of people boxing up food. That'll be a good turnout, and that's the way we show love. But be sure to remind people they're loved in Jesus, that God loves them, and Jesus is the reason we know that. So, how can we expect people out in the world to hear the Holy Spirit calling them to invite them into God's love if we don't share His love with them? And if we're not good at sharing it with one another, how can we share it with others? Remember, wherever we share love, there is Christmas. Now, motion results in emotion. If you do it, you'll start believing it and feeling it. And so that's why it's so important for us to practice love in our families and in our church family. Because the ability to love is not so based on a promise as it is a practice. If you don't practice your love, then you're not going to really feel that love. And if you're not feeling lovely, loving and lovely, then you need to start practicing love more. So is there someone in your life who's difficult to love, who makes it awkward and uncomfortable for you? Start by praying for them, but then also start to really try to love them, because it can make all the difference in your relationship. And remember, every time you do it, you're bringing Christmas afresh into the world. Now, also, when you're out in the world, there might be people that make you uncomfortable. And one time, I had an event that happened a while back that really reminded me of Hebrews chapter 13, where it says, don't forget to entertain strangers, because by doing so, you have entertained angels unaware. Now, if you're like me, when I'm out in the world, I want to be cautious. I don't want anyone to take advantage of me or do any of those things. I want to be wise. I want to be pleasant, but I want to be wise. And so I was in the grocery store. I went to get some soda, because it was on sale and we like soda. But as I normally do, I got distracted by something else. And I had put my purse in the top of the cart and I left it over on one side of the aisle, but I was over on the other side of the aisle. And after, I was just, you know, kind of paying attention, but kind of not. And then I noticed out of the corner of my eye, a person coming towards my purse. And I was like, oh, my purse, you know. So I turned around to pay attention, and there was this scruffy looking guy. And I was like, you better not take my purse. I'm standing right here watching it, you know, giving him the stink eye. Not that you ever give out a stink eye, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. If you want some stink eye, I can take you into the nursery and have some experts show you how to do a stink eye. They give it to me anyway. So I was giving, you know, the stink eye, and then he walked. Of course, he didn't care about my purse. He was trying to find whatever he was looking for. So I go over to the soda aisle, the soda display, and I get ready to pick up a 24-pack and put it in my cart. And it was not sealed very well. You know what's happening. I picked it up, and the cans just rolled across the floor. Yes. Yes. Fortunately, none of them broke open. I've had that happen at home. That is a disaster. So before I could even, you know, figure out what was going on and try to corral this cans full of soda into my cart, guess who was picking up the soda cans on the floor? You know it. Stink eye. Yep. That's exactly right. He showed Christ to me. And I told him after he got done, I said, you are my angel today. Of course, he looked at me like I was crazy, but that's okay. He was an angel. And I was convicted. I need to be more loving and gentle, especially to people that might look prickly. They need my love, and they have something maybe to give me. Like he was a savior. He really rescued me out of that mess. Because, a 24-pack of soda, that is a lot of cans. Whoosh, it was a mess. But God sent him. So don't forget, when you're out there loving people, that they might be messengers from God. And that if you're loving them, God will see that. And remember, God blesses you when you bless other people. He promises and he does it. So when we share love, there is Christmas. And so we also, when you share love, you experience much better feelings, that you get lifted up, that you get peace, you get joy, you get hope, that you are encouraged as well as they are encouraged. That's one of the greatest secrets of life, that when you share love, you can get it back. But more importantly, the truth is when you're out there in the world and you're with people that you think they don't need anything from you, that's a lie. Everyone needs love, and everyone needs it, what we can offer them in Jesus. And so we can use our speech to tell them, we can love them in our actions, and we can love them by what we do and other things for them. So living a life of love is our challenge this week, not only by what we do, but especially by what we say. So examine the areas of your life. Who is it that you need to be more loving towards? It's probably someone that is in your household. Maybe it's the person that looks at you in the mirror. You know, you're to love yourself too. Speak the truth that God loves you in Jesus Christ, that God's great love for you is shown through Jesus, that you are loved by God, and that as we love, the Holy Spirit will fill our life and bless us in powerful ways. When we give, we receive in the kingdom of God. And then we can have confidence and boldness to do amazing things. And we won't have to worry. If we're living a life of love that God calls us to in Jesus, then we won't have to worry when we come before the throne of heaven. We'll feel comfortable because we're at home. Let us pray together. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, help us to love others. Remind us that when we love our families, there is Christmas. When we love our neighbors, there is Christmas. When we love our church friends, there is Christmas. When we love the stranger, there is Christmas. When we love ourselves, there is Christmas. Remind each of us, Lord, that we are loved by you, and we know that best through Jesus. We thank you for that great love that through all things are possible and that can help us to do things. Help us to be willing to be uncomfortable and to love others and find out how it changes our world for good. We ask all this in the name of love, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Alice, before we take communion, which is the evidence of God's great love for us in Jesus, we have some prayer concerns. I'm sorry, my throat. So Ruth Bosman is doing better. She fell Monday and broke her collarbone and has a really black eye. But she is at Even Glow and doing better. I saw her Thursday. Richard Faust has been falling a lot, so please keep him in your prayers. Anita Pollock, who comes here to late service, had a bad case of COVID. And then she also had some internal bleeding, so please keep her in your prayers. Jane and Alan Hoffman's grandson, Christian, also had COVID, and now he has some heart problems. He's a young man. We need to keep David, the other Hoffman's son, Hoffman's landscaper's son, in our prayers, 24, who has blood clots on his brain and has to have surgery. Marshall Sankin had his knee replacement and is doing okay. Doing awesome. Well, good. And Janice Mattson still in the hospital. Harold Bissey is at home on hospice, so please keep him and his family in your prayers. And please keep people who are continuing to heal from other things, like Jill Mann from her knee surgery and Mary Picarney from her shoulder surgery. Wanda's here, but please keep praying for her. Judy and Randall Ferris are both sick today, and we have a lot of people that are battling flus and other things, so please be praying for them, and please try to keep yourself safe with good hand hygiene and all the things we need to do that. So you have your own friends and family that are on your hearts and minds, and so as we go to God, please take those concerns to him in the love that he has for you and for them. So let's be in an attitude of prayer together. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for a fun Christmas parade yesterday, for good weather for that, for the many ways that you bless us, all the fun beauty of the Christmas lights in this dark time of year, and the fun of giving and receiving presents and all the joy that surrounds the season. But especially, we thank you so much for sending Jesus. He is the greatest gift ever, that his great love for us is so enormous that we can't even really comprehend it. But let us today, through the act of communion, experience that love in fresh ways. And we do ask in your great love, Lord, that you pour out your healing on those who are sick. We're especially mindful of the Pharisees as they're battling flu and others who have flus and colds. We pray for your healing on them. We pray for your healing on Ruth and Richard, on Anita, on Marshall, on David and Christian, on Janice and Jill and Mary and Wanda and others that we name in our hearts before you. We ask your special peace and grace rest with Harold and his family at this transitional time in his life as he is preparing for the life to come. And we do pray for any who are grieving today that your great comfort will rest on them and help them to cling tightly to the promise of the resurrection. We pray for Garrett and Gavin Leach as they have lost their grandfather this week, and we just pray your great comfort rests with them and others who are grieving and have folks that need healing. We just pray, Lord, that you hear us. We know you hear us, and we just pray we can trust and await your deliverance. And as we're preparing to take communion, Lord, as our hearts are before you, we just pray that you forgive us for the ways we fail to live in love. We fail to live in our identity and the power that you give us. Please forgive us and cleanse us and heal us in all the ways that we need it. We just ask, O Lord, that your special blessing rest on each of us, and especially on others who aren't with us today, that they'll know your love and that we can be beacons and carriers of that love out into this hard and dark world. We thank you so much for that great love that we do know best in Jesus. And we continue in our time of prayer praying as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as we prepare to take communion, I'd remind you, friends, that this table is the Lord's, and he invites to it all. Any who earnestly repented their sin and seek to live at peace with one another, any who desire to live in love are welcome. So you friends at home, get your communion elements ready, and you can partake as I instruct you. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to the Father for it. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat of this, all of you. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after they had supped, he took the cup and he gave thanks to the Father for it. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and drink of this, all of you. For this cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So as often as we eat this bread, in whatever forms it may present itself, wafer, cracker, this bread pieces that you'll be receiving, and as often as we drink this cup, again, in whatever forms it may present itself, we are proclaiming the Lord's death and resurrection until he comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Let us pray together. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and those at home and on these gifts of bread and juice, that they may be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for this hurting world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Fill us anew with your love. Let this communion be an encounter afresh with your presence, gracious and loving God, that we can be your people and live with the mark of the cross of Jesus Christ, sacrificing in love for this world. We thank you, Lord, that you loved us so much that you gave us Jesus. And we thank you that we can live in that love and be your people here as we prepare for the life to come. We praise you and give you the glory always through Jesus' precious name and in the power of your Holy Spirit. And all God's people say, amen. I'll invite the communion servers forward. And as they're coming, you can prepare yourselves. Do you want to take communion again? Have the gluten-free bread and the common chalice. If you'd like to dip and take intinction, you're welcome to. Otherwise, you can kneel at the altar, and you're welcome to stay at the altar as long as you would wish. All is ready. Come to Christ's table. Thank you. Well, thanks be to our great God who gives us the victory over all things in Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our closing praise as we prepare to depart. Joy to the world, unspeakable joy. As we prepare to depart, receive the benediction. Friends, as you go forth, be bold in how you love, be strong and courageous, and know that as you love, our God loves you in Jesus Christ. And that love knows no bounds and has no beginning or end. And in that love, you can do all things. So go forth in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, knowing our God is Emmanuel and he is with us. Go with God. Amen. 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 Let's depart in peace.
Ta-da. Thank you.
I'm going to do that.